Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. All right, folks, if you'll find a seat, please. And open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 12. We will be studying this morning verses 46 through 50. As we complete this amazing chapter, we in fact will be moving to a chapter that begins a new course of study for the disciples, for the people, for those that have received the blessing of the Holy Spirit's teaching, and those that haven't. So this morning we will be completing Matthew 12 as we study and to some degree become concerned about family ties. And all of us have family, all of us have relations, we have kin, we have people that have some level of influence in our lives. We're going to talk about the power of the message with respect to those that are also messengers in your life. Jesus has been engaged in a lengthy argument, you might say, and I think it's surely a one-sided argument with respect to the power and wisdom of our omniscient and omnipotent God. Jesus is speaking with scribes and Pharisees. They have been attempting to discredit Him, to remove Him from the position of being accounted as the Son of David, a Messiah, as the people have responded to His healing of this blind and deaf man who is possessed with a devil. In the exorcism of this devil, of this demon in this man, he sees and he speaks, and the people are marveling at that and say, is this then the Son of David, the Messiah? Is this a deliverer whom we have been waiting for? Pharisees pick that up, and they immediately attempt to move the conversation from Jesus to something that would discredit Him. They speak in terms of Him being in league with Beelzebub, the Lord of the Flies. They speak in terms that are nonsense, and Jesus proves that just through simple human logic. But they also attempt to prove that Jesus is disqualified because He's so exclusionary. Verse 46, where we begin our study on family ties. So while He was speaking to the multitudes, behold, His mother and brothers stood outside seeking to speak with Him. Now, there's no doubt that the Pharisees were attempting to misrepresent Jesus everywhere that it was possible. And because Nazareth is so close to the Galilee, in fact, it's in the Galilean area, it actually is a city of Galilee, surely this misrepresentation and these redirections from the praise of Jesus had affected not only the people of Galilee, but it affected perhaps even the people of Nazareth. And so we find at this point Jesus' mother and His brothers. coming to Capernaum to see if they perhaps could assist or come alongside their brother who has, we'll see in Mark chapter 3, lost his mind. We know that his brothers, of course, except for his half-brother James, we're told in John chapter 7, verse 5, did not believe in him. Now, it's an astonishing truth in Scripture, and this is really true for a lot of Roman Catholics, that Jesus had brothers and sisters. Turn to Mark chapter 3. We'll look at verses 20 and 21, and what we discovered there is, in fact, a testimony not just found in Mark, but found in three of the Gospels concerning Jesus having half-brothers and half-sisters. Now, this flies against the pronouncement from Rome that Mary was an immaculate perpetual virgin. Not so. She was a wife and she was a mother. And through her husband Joseph, bore many children. Mark 3, verse 20. When the multitude came together again so that they could not so much as eat bread. But when his own people heard about this, they went out to lay hold of him, for they said, he is out of his mind. Now, the New King James Version translates that short phrase in verse 21, his own people, in the manner in which I've just read. All of the other most popular translations and forms of the New Testament translate it differently. And literally, in the Greek, it refers to his own family. In the English Standard Version, and when his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying he is out of his mind. The New International Version, 1984. When his family heard about this, they wanted to take charge of him, for they said, he is out of his mind. The New Revised Standard Version, when his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, he has gone out of his mind. The New Living Translation, when his family heard what was happening, they tried to take him away, for they said, he is out of his mind. Now, that's an interesting statement, because at least from Mary and what's recorded in the New King James Version, Mary and the half-brothers of Jesus, they have come with great concern as a multitude is pressing against them in the house of Peter. And their family has come, perhaps in the far outlying perimeter of this great multitude. And it quickly comes, at least through the crowd or perhaps through messengers, to Jesus that your family is outside on the perimeter of the multitude and they are gravely concerned for you, for they are saying he is out of his mind. Now, that's a tough thing to swallow. It really is. It's tough to think in terms of Mary at this point really misunderstanding the message and ministry of Jesus, her own son. I suppose it can be rationalized that among my own, for a long period, my own sisters misunderstood my, in my family, my unique love for Jesus Christ and the total restructuring, reordering of my life because of his presence in my life. My father never accepted it. My mother always was hoping I'd get a real job. My younger sister finally came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and serves him diligently today. My oldest sister, I've not had contact with for over 12 years, but I get occasional Facebook messages that are pretty virulent. What's up with all that? Well, when we begin to understand the message of Jesus Christ, it's really a message that forces people to consider the challenge of whether or not they are born again. Not reformed, not religionized, but rather regenerated by the blood of Jesus Christ. That's the message that we bring. That's the message that changed the world 2,000 years ago. It's the message that changes our lives today. That Jesus
died on the cross, gave his life as a victor over death and the grave, rose again, and has shared the glory of his presence in our lives by we receiving this fellowship with him once and for all. Now, the fact that his mother and his brothers have come, there is no mention of Joseph, basically outside of Matthew chapter 2. We suspect Joseph has passed away at this point. His mother, his brothers have come, and they are asking to speak with him. Now, the point of this we see in Mark chapter 3, the point of their asking to speak with him is, in fact, to handcuff him, to take him with them back to Nazareth, to bring him back to reality. Perhaps they've believed the reports of the Pharisees. Perhaps they have misinterpreted the power of the Holy Spirit upon him and the sense of just how much glory this man really occupies. One said to him in verse 47, "Look, your mother and your brothers are standing outside seeking to speak with you." But he answered and said to the one who told him, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" And he stretched out his hands toward his disciples and he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers." Matthew, later in chapter 13, we see what seems to be a very similar encounter. This is the next chapter. This is after Jesus is speaking his parables. And again, the family returns, comes to Jesus, and they are seeking to take him back with them to Nazareth. It says in Matthew chapter 13, verse 55, "Is this not the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judah, and his sisters, are they not all with us? Where did this man get all these things?" So they were offended at him, but Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor, except in his own country and in his own house." We know Jesus had at least 4 half-brothers. We know he had at least 2 half-sisters. Now, this means there's an entourage of perhaps 7 that are standing outside the multitude in the city of Capernaum. They have come to take Jesus. They are all direct relatives of Jesus' mother. And their methodology is one to retrieve him, for they believe he is out of his mind. This is perfect. This is exactly what the Pharisees have been hoping to instill in the hearts of the people of Israel. He's crazy. This is some nut burger from Nazareth. And we know what kind of people the Galileans are. They're rebels. They're revolutionaries. And we can just, in a very general term, just discount them anyways. The people of his own city are saying, "You know what? You know, who is this? Wasn't he the carpenter's son? What's he all up about?" The question has perhaps invaded even your own hearts, those that are saved, and you're wondering, have I chosen the right team? Have I trusted in he who in fact is the Lord God Almighty? Or if I, like Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, am I to be the most pitiable because Jesus has not risen from the dead? And my faith is empty, and I'm still in my sins. The good news is that Jesus goes from there in Matthew 13 and begins to teach the truth of the kingdom of God. I'm looking forward to chapter 13 simply because we are going to see powerful truths coming from 7 parables. I was about to take my shoes off. 7 parables. The follow along with the 7 letters to the churches of Revelation in chapters 2 and 3 of Revelation. We're going to see that the Lord is calling you to an intimacy in relationship that cannot be born out of just a reformative process. It can only be born out of a regenerative. Is that a word? a process. You must be born again, he said in John 3 to Nicodemus. Friends, you must be born again. But let me tell you what kind of cost that may involve in your life. Just like Jesus, his own family turned against him. Why? Because his message was a challenging message. And the message of all the religious leaders at that point were seeking to reform people through the law, but Jesus was saying, no, I want to regenerate you through the Spirit of the living God. And it's going to look entirely different in your life. Jesus was being dominated by a message that completely disqualified him as the Messiah, as the high priest king of Israel. He said, here are my mother and my brothers. Why did he say that? Why did he say, no, not those seven outside the multitude, but here, all these people that are pressing in. These are my mother, my brothers, my sisters. These are the people that are meaningful to me. He tells us why in verse 50, for whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. Jesus says, you want to be my friend? Then obey my commandments. Obey my... What are the commandments of Jesus? Fairly simple, but how deep they are. To love the Lord your God with all your heart and mind, soul, and strength. To love God means that you are placing every portion of your personal will in submission to the will of the living God. Jesus did this himself. When in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, even so, not my will, but thy will be done. Would you say that as well? That's a it's a reforming process. Dennis, look that word up so you can help me out, right? What about other people in your own city? I live fairly far from where I was raised, but people that are friends of mine from high school, et cetera, from 21 years living in my hometown, still have contact with me, and it's intriguing the comments they still make with respect to how religious WUG has become, how religious Paul is. See, they misunderstand what Jesus has done in my life. They don't want to hear the story behind the regeneration. They want to simply make a judgment and disqualify any other portion of my testimony. Has that happened to you? It's going to happen. Jesus says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate, and really that English word is, there's a better translation, and a better translation would be to prefer above. If anyone comes to me and does not prefer me above their father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and his own life, he cannot be my disciple. You see, reformative processes just change about an inch deep. Regeneration changes every portion of you. Paul says, a new man, a new person. The renewing of our mind, Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I want to be transformed by the renewing of my mind. This is a plea to the living God. Please regenerate me. Fill me, O mighty God, with a power to be able to resist temptation, to live in the Spirit of the living God, to abide in Christ and walk with him, enduring the persecution of even family members, of people of my own hometown, of people that just simply refuse to understand the transformative process and testimony of my life. I've attempted to give it to people. Maybe you have as well. And they want to change the story. That's so generally true of people today in the world. It's all about their story. It's all about me time. It's all about, you know, what's happened. I can one-up that. Okay. And most Christians are willing to listen. Most Christians are willing in the heart of the Lord to empathize, sympathize with the struggles of people because we remember how we struggled, what our life story was like before the Spirit came into our lives. But friends, the testimony of your life is perhaps one of the most powerful things that we have as a tool against the devil and to bring people to Christ. Because I once was this man, but more importantly, now I am this man. Not because of some 12-step program, but because Jesus has caused me by the Spirit of God to be born again. So we find Jesus with the devil against him, the leaders against him, parents and siblings against him. Why not just give up? Why not just go back to Nazareth and start pounding nails again? Why not just put all the hopes of heaven aside and get some me time? Why not just buy a boat? Go sailing on the Galilee without the nuisance of these people asking questions, seeking ministry. I just want to be on the boat by myself for a while. Why not? Why not buy a motorhome? Instead of traveling with these silly caravans down to Jerusalem 3 times a year, I'm going to go north. I'm going to go west, young man. I'm going to spend some time on the beach near Tel Aviv. Why not? Why bother with all this negativity? Aren't you glad that he didn't give up? But friends, I mention this because I want you to know that the pressures in your life are similar, if just but a tip of the iceberg, to the pressures in Jesus' life. The government was upon his shoulder, and the iniquity of us all were laid upon him. Jesus couldn't give up because he was headed directly for the cross. And he knew that there could be no exaltation until there was the ultimate submission. I ask you this morning, have you ultimately submitted to the will of your Heavenly Father? His will is that you would know his Son, Jesus, and that you would receive him and be regenerated, reborn again by the Spirit of the living God. He knows, your Father in heaven knows, that there is only one thing from heaven itself that can truly change your life eternally. And that's welcoming, inviting, yes, opening the door to Jesus to come into you and have fellowship with you for eternity. It's going to cost you something. It's going to, at times, be agonizing. But every good thing from heaven's bounds become yours. And you will never be alone. You will never be forsaken. You will have the grace and the mercy of a mighty living God who in that very hour will give you what to say in the Holy Spirit. I invite you this morning. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. I invite you this morning. Welcome Jesus into your life. I want you to know that he seeks you this very moment. He desires you this very moment. He desires that none would perish. He desires you this moment. He desires to have an intimate relationship with you. It's born out of his love for you. It's born out of his grand concern that he does not want to see you apart from him for eternity. And there's only one way to gain entrance into heaven, and that is through the blood of Jesus Christ. No other way, no other truth, no other life. No man comes unto my Father except through me, Jesus said. Simple prayer opens that door, and Jesus will come rushing in. Doesn't mean you're going to fall on the ground and start frothing or run to the stage and start speaking in, you know, Hebrew. But it does mean that your life will never, ever be the same. You've resisted the Holy Spirit up to now. Welcome him. He wants to occupy, place in order. Yes, reform, but most importantly, regenerate your innermost being, your heart of hearts, your mind, your spirit, your soul. If I'm speaking to you, and you know if the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, right where you're seated, would you just raise your hand? And by raising your hand, what you're saying is, you know what? I give in. I give in and I give up to the Holy Ghost this morning. I give my life to Jesus. Thank you for those hands that have been raised. I give in, I give up to Jesus. Come, what you're going to pray is, come Holy Spirit, come and fill my life, come and occupy and possess my life, because I can't stand another moment on my own. I need you, oh Lord of heaven, to come into me. That's what you're going to be saying. There have been 10, 12 hands that have raised. Please, you still have a moment. But here's what I'm bringing you to. Thank you. This simple prayer. Nothing simple happens. But this simple prayer invites the Lord of glory into your life. Repeat after me, and I'd like you to say it out loud so that your own ears hear you saying this unto the Lord your God. Here's a simple prayer. Repeat after me. Father in heaven, I give my life to Jesus. Wash me in your blood, Jesus. Wash me of my sin. Cleanse me of my wrongdoing. And make me new. Give me a new heart, Father. Give me a new mind, Jesus. Fill me, Holy Spirit, where I once was empty. Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.